with Starley.
Oh, hello. I apologize for the ultra low quality because it's kind of low light right now because it's currently 8:14 as I'm starting this. This is the last Ask Blue Stolly of 2018, and I really should be packing right now because I'm supposed to be jumping onto an airplane very, very early tomorrow morning to head out of the country. But before I do that, I wanted to make sure that I appeared in your screen one last time in this year. Doesn't matter if it's the next year that you see this, but I wanted to make sure that I appeared in your screen one more time before I leave, because I love you. Ordinarily, I would take the time to write out, a very well thought out answer with jokes peppered along the way, and, you know, trying to make things very interesting, but I don't have that kind of time right now, so we're just gonna wing this entire thing, which is a giant mistake that we'll all pay for, and I'm glad you're along for the ride. Some of these are all kind of variations on the same sort of question, so I grouped a few of the things together. There were a lot that kind of came in. So, Malchik asks, what inspires you during creating your own music? Brandon asks, how did you get into making your own music, and what or who inspired you? And Justice Pope asks, what inspired you to pursue a career in music? And really, like all of those questions and anything related to, you know, like anything that inspired me to begin doing this, to start making noise, to start putting things out for you guys, all kind of comes back to the same thing, and that's that when I was growing up and going through incredibly hard times, it was always music and art and literature and things like that that got me through, particularly music. When I would sit there in it would be like 2 o'clock in the morning, I'd be 12 years old, sitting in the dark with headphones on, listening to music that I loved, trying to reverse engineer what all was going on, and music is what got me through the hardest times. Music is what saved me. And even more recently, asthma's awesome. When things were going really, really kind of askew for me, music is what got me through. And I remember very early on vowing that if I could just get through the things that I was going through at the time, that I would sort of pay that back by dedicating my life to just making music and putting things out there, and hopefully that would do something for someone else out there, even if it only affects one person. But if I could just do something that positively affects someone else and helps someone else get through similar dark times, then it's all worth it. So the inspiration is partially for myself to, like, you know, get things out there and be a creative expression and things like that. But more importantly, it's that I hope that someone else gets something out of it, whoever that person may be. It could be you watching this. It could be someone who doesn't even know that this video exists. All I care about is that that it does something positive in the world. Two more of a similar kind. Gabby asks, do you ever get stuck in the creation process? If so, what do you do to get unblocked? And Victor, which I should have enlarged this before I started filming, I'll do that now. Victor asks, do you ever have times where you feel like you struggle with a lack of motivation and creativity? If so, what do you do when that happens? And I hope the new year brings you many good things. Tell you what, I hope everyone watching this, I hope the new year brings you many great things. Good, great, awesome, whichever. I hope 2019 is very good to all of you. I get stuck in that part a lot, where just nothing is working, and like the song feels impossible or the task feels impossible. The most important thing is just to keep pushing through. Pretty much every song that I've done has had a point where it's like, well, this song is impossible. I can't finish it. I don't know what to do for this end part, or I don't know what to do for this chorus. Sometimes that's just a matter of taking a walk outside the studio, go listen to something else, go read something, or, you know, watch half of a movie, or just go take a stroll down to the little awesome Thai joint that's down the street from the studio. And on that little 15-minute walk, oh, crap, I've got an idea. I know how the drums should be for this song. That doesn't matter. The important thing is just keep going. It doesn't matter what the creative block is. It doesn't matter how insurmountable the task feels, as long as you just keep pushing forward, and in my case, I just keep beating my head against a wall. As long as you keep going, then eventually you will find the answer. Because it's what I've done so far, and it's worked out okay. Cryptric asks, what is your music of choice when driving around town? Thank you for being such a huge inspiration to me. If I'm not mistaken, Cryptric, you are the one who put together that awesome meme chart version that Jason Paradise played of The Fall that was like a mashup beyond all mashups, full of just bizarre, hilarious meme goodness. So thank you, because I still laugh about that thing and I still play it for people to the confusion of everyone around me, and they love it. It's one of the funniest things I've heard, so thank you. You're an inspiration. As far as what I drive around town and listen to, I grab my phone so I can show you what's on this thing. I got this app that you can like check out books and audiobooks with your library card. So I have Walter John Williams' Hardwired, which was like an 80s cyberpunk, also ran alongside the whole, you know, all the good guys like William Gibson and stuff like that. I had never read that book. It was always on my list, so I'm currently making my way through that. Prior to that, I listened to the audiobook of No One Gets Out Alive by Adam Neville, and it was fantastic. One of my favorite horror books ever. Really well written, really well performed in the audiobook. I highly recommend the audiobook of that. As far as music, I like tracker music and stuff like that, so I like loading up old XM and S3M and IT files on my phone and listening to that in my car, because I'm a giant dork. Kai asks, what's your favorite thing about working on your albums? And Kai, I wish I could tell you that the favorite part for me was the instant that I've finished it and that I've sent it off out into the world, knowing that I've completed a task, but that's only part of it. The actual favorite part of working on all of these albums out of any of the music that I do is when I see that people are enjoying it. So when I see people posting on, you know, Twitter and Instagram and YouTube and Facebook and VK and all the various social media networks that I did not list, wherever. Even just in person, someone saying that they enjoyed a record or that they enjoyed a song. When I see that the music is doing something positive for someone else, or that it affected them in some way, or that it got them through something, or that they just liked playing it really loud and yelling along with it, knowing that the music has connected with someone and that it's doing something for you is my favorite part of doing any album. Tyler asks, what do you define your music genre as? Your creative genius, not a genius, has shown me your unique style of industrial, electronic, big beat, metal, and acoustic, but how would you define yourself? That's a surprisingly difficult question. I have no idea. I always wanted to do just a multi-genre thing. I never wanted to like tie myself down to just one style, because when I was a kid, I would listen to movie soundtracks, you know, like the band movie soundtrack sort of thing, where it would be just a bunch of different artists coming together doing songs that were all in service of like one film and one sort of vibe and atmosphere. I would listen to that and think, why does this all have to be different artists? Why can't this be one artist? And I sort of like fashioned myself after that, like after movie soundtracks and stuff like that, which is why it has sort of a cinematic bent, probably. I don't know. That's actually a better question for all of you guys. Down in the comments, let me know, what would you define Blue Stahli as? Scott asks, do you find tracker-type software more conductive to creativity compared to modern DAWs because they limit yet focus you, or is it just down to pure retro coolness? If you don't know what Scott is referring to, that is because my primary DAW is Renoise, which is like a next-gen, like tracker software sort of thing. And Scott, the answer is probably a little from column A, a little from column B. I started making music on trackers, so that's naturally just how my brain works and how I see music when I'm listening to something that I like. I try to envision it as a tracker sort of thing, or I try to envision it like all in the hexadecimal, you know, vertical rows and stuff like that. I did stuff in Pro Tools. I record some live stuff in Cubase, but they're not my go-tos. They're sort of like a means to an end, which is recording something to dump out, to throw into Renoise, to really have fun, because that's how I used to make music. I would record things into Cool Edit and then dump them out into Impulse Tracker or Mod Plug Tracker, or before that, Scream Tracker, and that's how I would make music, and those were always the most exciting times when I was doing that as well. So part of it takes me back to that retro nostalgia time of, you know, being alone in a dark room trying to figure out how to do electronic music. And the other part of it is that it's what makes sense to me, and I'm a big believer in it's not what you use, it's how you use it. So whether you use Ableton or FL or Cubase, it doesn't matter what you use, whatever is the most comfortable for you, that's what you should be using. You know, you could make an entire album on stuff on your phone. It doesn't matter. As long as you're doing something that's true to you, then that's what you ought to be doing. For me, it's my incredibly nerdy tracker stuff, because I love the hell out of it, and this is definitely what I'm going to be doing forever. Staz asks, is there anything you would have loved to change in already released songs, and what track do you wish would have gotten more attention? It's two questions, I'll hit you with two answers. As far as things that I would love to change in already released songs, that's pretty much every single song, and it's why I can't listen back to things that I've already put out. I can maybe pop it on every now and again, but I can't listen through the entire thing, because all I hear is the stuff that I would like to do differently. Because the song is never really done, it's just you have to stop working on it and turn it in and give it to people. It could be down to like, oh, I should have swapped out this kick drum for this kick drum, or I should have done this different thing in the mix versus this, or I should have maybe, you know, done this little lyrical turn differently. And if I did that in perpetuity, I would never release any song ever. So at some point, I just have to stop and put it out there. And I think that's probably anyone who does anything creative, if they're a writer, they probably, you know, they probably look back at page 37 like, ooh, I should have done this paragraph way differently. And that's pretty much me with every song. As far as things that I wish would have gotten more attention, that's hard to say, because it's tough to know exactly who all out there is connecting with what. I will say that the song Demon is probably my favorite thing off of The Devil, and I hope everyone enjoys that song as much as I do. And another, where there are multiple similar questions, I only screen capped two of them, but there were a couple like this. Eric asks, what is next for you in 2019? Any more random shenanigans? And Benedict asks, what are your plans for 2019? 2019, we'll see some awesome new things. 2018 sucked ass. It was tragedy on top of tragedy, and then getting dragged through the mud on top of that tragedy. So, by the law of averages, 2019 should be pretty good. I'm back at work working on brand spanking new material, both Blue Stolly and Sunset Neon, for you. So you will be getting a new Blue Stolly record in 2019. I'm aiming to put together, finally, a live show that I can start coming to your town and meeting you in person and jumping around on stage like a spider monkey. This will finally be put into place. I'm excited to make brand spanking new music for you. There are many demos written for for the new record. There are other things that are very exciting that I can't talk about, but if they come to fruition, will be very, very cool. And as soon as I'm allowed to tell you about it, then I will. I'm chomping at the bit to tell you right now, and I can't. But I'll be jumping right back on here to tell you all about it. 2019 will be very cool. Absolutely stay tuned. You can follow along on the Instagram, which is this down here, because I'll be posting stories of, like, here's new songs that I'm working on. Or, if I'm not allowed to play you what the audio is, here's at least what it looks like, or I'll describe it to you while I'm walking down the street back to that, Thai joint I mentioned earlier. Anyway, 2019 will be something fantastic. It will be a catalyst for goodness and new things, and I hope that it will be for you as well, and I will be happy to make your soundtrack for the new year. And finally, Rowan asks, I know you don't consider yourself famous as such, but what's it like knowing that you're absolutely someone's favorite music artist? That's very nice. First of all, I don't consider myself famous at all. I'm not famous, not at all. I'm just a dude making noise. But as for the other part of that question, knowing that anything that I could do, sorry, asthma's awesome. Knowing that anything that I could do would be someone's favorite music, or that I could even potentially be someone's favorite music artist, means the absolute world. I'm extremely humbled by everyone, by every single comment that I see when someone says how much a song means to them, or that they connect with this album, or that this song got them through, or it just made them happy for a little bit during the daytime. Just even knowing that you guys are listening to this stuff is incredible. If I could be your favorite artist, that's awesome. If I'm like your 15th artist on your rotation, like, oh, I haven't listened to that in years. Yeah, this is still pretty good. Even that, awesome. I'll take it. I'm extremely humbled and blown away that you guys are listening to this and connecting with it, and I appreciate every single one of you so much. And there will be much, much more coming for you that I'll be working on just for you. I gotta stop myself from tearing up here. Thank you guys very much, and I love you.